Digital Romance TV.
Hey folks, how are you? It's Michael Fiore and the lovely and talented Nora Blake from digitalromance.tv. Today we're talking about the five reasons it's so hard
five reasons
it's so hard to move on from your divorce. You've been divorced.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So let's talk about that. To me, the number one reason so many people have a hard time moving on, like finding somebody else, finding love again, has to do with shame. You know, shame's a powerful word.
Red-faced, tell me, embarrassed. Yeah. Instead of describing what shame is, tell me what you mean by in this context.
I mean the shame of having made this huge mistake. So oftentimes when you get divorced from somebody, you start thinking of them as another person. You start seeing, especially if you've gone through the horrible divorce process with money and kids and everything else, you learn things about who this person is, at least you think they are, that you never would have seen before, and you say to yourself, how could I be so stupid?
Yeah, for me, the shame portion was just the, like, it's so embarrassing of the public humiliation of getting a divorce.
Yep.
Because I think we touch on the other aspects of that human, that other human that you made the mistake with later, but I think the shame is actually from just the...
Oh, like the stigma.
Like you go out in the world and you celebrate and you have this huge party when you decide to spend the rest of your life with this person.
Yep.
And then you get divorced and you're supposed to just like hide away and, you know...
Well, it's the shame of failure.
Absolutely.
Right?
That's exactly what it is.
And that's what people see it as. Like whether you were married for 18 months or you were married for 18 years, people seem to think like, well, it didn't last forever, therefore I failed and I'm ashamed of that failure.
Yeah.
Because I was supposed to go into this and it was supposed to be perfect. And I was supposed to be the perfect husband or the perfect wife.
Yep.
And it was supposed to be, and we were going to buck the system. We were going to be the ones that actually, I know 60% of people get divorced, but we weren't going to. We weren't going to make our parents' mistakes.
Yep.
And that shame is a huge part of it. The only way to get past shame, by the way, is to forgive yourself.
Absolutely.
To be able to look at yourself and say, you were a different person once upon a time who made these decisions, and they ended up being wrong, but you weren't wrong for making them.
Sure.
Right? Number two, needing closure from your ex. Needing your ex to own up to what they quote-unquote did wrong, or needing in some way for them to apologize and say, you're right, I was wrong the entire time. They weren't wrong the entire time. It always takes two, no matter what it is. It's usually a 50-50-ish kind of split. But also, you're not going to get that.
Yep.
You're just not going to.
Yeah, I think for me, I'll just personally, little quick thing aside on that, is that it was really hard for me. I never got a clear and concise, he still, even though he started seeing somebody else immediately, even though he got married, you know, last year, he never would admit that it wasn't all my fault for us being apart.
Yep.
I was always to blame for us splitting up. I was always at fault. We would still be together and be happy together
if I hadn't
ended our marriage was the thing, which I'm looking and I'm going, you claim to love this other human and it's still my fault. We were not happy, like just because he couldn't see that. So that was really hard to get over that part because I couldn't get him to admit that he was as unhappy as I was in our marriage.
I also think there's a big thing here around the idea of a lot of people when they get divorced or whatever else, it is so easy to either fall into that trap of blaming yourself for everything or blaming them for everything.
Absolutely.
Right? And if you're blaming them for everything, the danger with blaming yourself for everything is you end up self-loathing and you don't understand the good things about you and you see yourself as somebody who's unlovable and all that other stuff, which is awful. Blaming somebody else for everything means that you don't learn and change at all. There's a lack of self-awareness there. And you find, and everyone wants to be the good guy. And all of us want to be the hero in our own story. But when you blame someone else for everything, you don't learn from the experience and you're not going to be able to be better in the future. It's okay to look at yourself and say, hey, wow, I fucked this up in certain ways and I learned from it.
Right.
Right? And moving on from there. Next, buyer's remorse. Go ahead.
God, what was I thinking? How could I have fallen in love with this freaking idiot? Is basically what that looks like.
And by the way,
we all go through it at some point. Like, what is wrong with me? That I went there, that I had that relationship, that I spent that long working with this person that's so, like, dumb and horrible now. Like, that's, you know, all the things you have to feel to get closure and move on, you then turn it back on yourself and, like, there's something wrong with me that I made this stupid choice.
And the answer to that is to forgive yourself for being human.
Absolutely.
Go watch Helen Fisher's TED Talk on love and how love actually works and what love does to your brain, the chemical reactions, oxytocin, dopamine, et cetera, that go on in your brain when you fall in love. And you'll understand why you were that stupid.
I blame 9/11.
Yeah, because I blame 9/11. This for everything at this point?
No, just for... Yeah.
Yeah. Number four is stereotyping, as what was what I called it here. But the idea is, a lot of times we get so many emails from people saying, "Michael, how can I ever trust a man again after what my ex did to me, etc." just because your ex was a douchebag in some ways doesn't mean all men were douchebags, right? Or just because your ex was a bitch doesn't mean that all women are bitches.
And also, there's something to be said for, like, when my first marriage, when I was young and stupid and 19, and I was married for a year and a half and separated for the last half year of that, I went to a therapist because I was like, this guy, like, I don't ever want to do this again, please. Yeah. And talked through, and I literally only went once, but having somebody to talk through all of the reasons why and all the things I was going through and all of the stuff, and like, because I made this very, at a very young age, realization that this was not something I ever wanted to repeat. Yep. I don't want to, because it was a really bad relationship. Mm-hmm. It was emotionally abusive. Okay. He was sexually addicted to me. Like, it was really...
Well, you are really hot. So.
Really... really bad relationship, and I had a lot of, like, this is not something that, so therapy is a really great thing to have somebody, because you're going to wear your friends out real fast if you're somebody who has to talk through things in order to process them, like me.
Yeah, and oftentimes when people fall into that stereotyping trap, it's just because your brain is reacting, it's trying to protect you in some ways.
Right.
It's like a dog, you know, I have a friend back in Grafton, Massachusetts, where I grew up, who has a dog who was abused by a large bald man when it was a puppy. And so when it sees me, that dog freaks the hell out every single time. I didn't do anything.
Right.
But that dog, you know, being a lower creature as it were, it can't see that. It just made the association that all large bald men always mean pain. And in your brain is making connection between men or women and that pain as well. There's ways to move through that, especially through therapy. And number five, kind of snarky but also true, social media, Facebook.
It's really hard. In general, you see, like, you know, somebody happy and, like, because we all paint the best picture on social media of our lives, or the worst, depending on your personality and what you're...
But most people paint the
best. And the best way to deal with that is to block all forms. Yes. I mean, literally block them. Don't just remove them as a friend. Block them. What it does, this is so beautiful, you never see their name.
Yep.
Facebook will never show you a picture, their comments on other friends' posts.
If they're tagged or anything like that.
If they're tagged, it'll only show you their name.
Yep.
You won't ever see, it blocks out all of your, so it's like a perception filter to remove them from your social media life.
Even if it's an amicable divorce, it's still good
to separate. It's really great to give you some time. At least 6 months. I'm 4 years in on the blocking, and it's still great.
And you still have to communicate with your ex.
Right, but I still don't want to see and hear everything he has to say all the time, because he's one of those, like, I must comment on every single thing that everybody posts. And so I got tired of every thread, like, there he was. And it takes that out. I never see his name anywhere.
Great. There's five things that are holding me back from moving on from your divorce, and some extra info on how to actually move on from your divorce. If you want to learn more about, you know, getting past these things, go to digitalromance.tv for more videos, or go to digitalromanceinc.inc for a whole bunch of articles. And also, do us a favor and leave a comment below telling how you managed to move past the pain and the suffering and the expectations of your divorce. Bye-bye.
If you've got a cell phone in your pocket or purse right now, then you've got everything you need to create incredible romance and passion with the man or woman in your life at the push of a button. Go to digitalromance.tv/TRB to see Michael Fiore make an entire audience of women on The Rachel Ray Show swoon and learn how to use tiny little text messages to have the relationship of your dreams.